Good evening.
Hello.
Today is presentation number 7 of 7 we have announced, and we are doing great. Thank you very much. We finished all of them. The subject matter for today has a very interesting title. It's actually, we're going to be examining the necessity of repentance for effective forgiveness. And the subject is wonderful because that gives us also an opportunity to look at all the 5 models that we have developed and revisited in the past few weeks. And that will help us to be able to solidify our understanding on the topic. Clearly, when we are talking about forgiveness and repentance, we are talking about emotions. So we have to examine, in other words, how these emotions themselves affect in our life, and then stipulate the requirements for repentance to be established. This is why I have the emotional spectrum model already found and identified and have it in our flip chart, so that we'll be able to put it into the right perspective. I hope you will enjoy it. Every time I do this presentation, it is the first time I do it in English, by the way. I've done it originally in Greek, and it was, I like it! It was very much, very much on top on the subject matter. So, I held it in mind to do it in English, and I'm glad that to materialize it in this opportunity. Alright, now, most of you have seen this model. There may be a person or so who may not have seen it for reasons that it didn't so happen to be here. But overall, this model talks loudly about something very, very important. It talks loudly from the point of view of telling us who we really are. Okay? We are emotional beings. What we really are, the whole creation, not just the humans, the whole creation is based on emotions. And therefore, the emotions represent us. I can bring you a couple of points just to remind you how important this kind of thinking is. First of all, we, at this point in our conversation, since nearly all of us have a certain level of understanding about my specific approach, so at this point everybody knows that what we really are, from the point of view of existential components, we are spirit. We are soul. We are part of a soul that a particular spiritual entity has created in order to be able to advance the God's divine plan. So on the basis of that, a soul is coming into existence, and this particular soul itself is creating a human being, a creation in general. Now, in other words, the soul is dedicated, a component of itself, to a new creation. Without this dedication, without this inspiration, the creation wouldn't have existed. It is the soul itself who gave its breath of life. And that breath of life remains within us and makes the difference for us to be creative and be lively and be productive and be all kinds of things. And when eventually, for some reason, this particular inspiration, this particular breath of fire that the soul has given us ceases to be interested in association with the physical body, the physical body collapses and the person is dead, although the body is not dead. That's the interesting part. The body is not dead after we die. That's why they can use components of it into replacing certain parts of a human body that doesn't work for other individuals and so forth. So the idea then is that we are created because of our soul, and the soul is distinguished as spirit, which it is, to have the substantial power of the capacity to think. So the spirit is thinking, and when we say that the spirit is thinking, then right away we are attaching to the fact that thinking is essential in order to make a decision, which means that the spirit makes decisions, which again means that the actual expression of the free will that we have, it's not our physical body who has it, it is the spirit who has it and exercises it and practices it. Okay? So in that sense, then halfway through here we just found out that the soul, which is the spirit, is the one who is thinking, and it is the one who actually materializes. Why? Because without thought we don't have emotions. So the emotions are the results of thoughts that are controlled by the spirit. There we are. The spirit has created us. Because the emotional or astral body is just that. They are the emotions that characterize us. Whatever we have inside us, whatever we express, whatever we represent, is the emotions we feel. Okay? So, out of this, therefore, existential body model, we just summarize that it is the spirit that is thinking, and because the spirit is thinking, it is creating emotions, and therefore we have the actual creation right here in the emotional or astral body. The question, what is left for the physical body? I'm sure you remember, not much. Not much, just whatever our senses allow us to be able to discern, to be able to see, to be able to identify in our environment. Everybody sees here an apartment, sees the lights, maybe too much for the size of the apartment, but maybe not enough for the purpose of this presentation, which is to get into the YouTube. However, all I'm saying is that whatever we think that it exists, which is our physical existence, is a minute component of what really exists. And the real existence happens in the causal planes, where the spirit reigns, and the physical body, who has its own spirit, otherwise it wouldn't have been alive at all, even though our existence, our spiritual existence disappears, then so that the physical body will be able to play its game. Now, throughout this creation process, we should not forget that there is one more very important element. All of this creation that the spirit entails through thinking and emotion creation by means of the thoughts it is facilitated by some active quality of energy that has been identified by very few individuals. Recently I found out something that really amazed me as well, because I just discovered that much of the Eastern civilizations didn't know this difference. They were mixed up on that. Okay, and that amazed me. Much of the Eastern civilizations, they believe that the thinking process is detrimental to the creation, because it does not allow the spirit to express itself. They don't understand, in other words, that it is the thinking that creates the creation. And that was something that I found it hard to believe. Anyway, so throughout this creation there is a very peculiar, a very special, a very unique existence of subtle energy that I call psychic energy or spiritual power, if you wish. There are lots of names on that. Certain civilizations call it they have other names which are indicative of the power it entails, because without that particular existence of this specific energy, the creation by itself wouldn't have reached to the level that we recognize it, even by default, through the limitations of our senses. A name that we have for this particular energy, it comes out of our own religion, incidentally. Our own religion recognizes that. Holy Spirit. It is the existence of the Holy Spirit that makes this creation a reality. The Holy Spirit works like a catalyst. The Holy Spirit is what makes the difference for the rest of the energy types available for each one of these energy zones, in order to be able to express themselves, transform, change, and create the creation. No Holy Spirit, that wouldn't have been. Now, mind you, go and talk to our spiritual fathers about Holy Spirit. They don't really understand what it's all about, of course. I'm not surprised about that. But the Holy Spirit, they put it next to God, and they don't understand why they put it next to God. It is the Holy Spirit that creates everything. Its existence, its mere existence, works as a catalyst for everything to stick together, transform, and create what we enjoy as materialization in life. Okay. To be able to see the differences of the emotions, or how important they are, we developed the emotional spectrum model. And we explained that in reality, what we have here is an energetic model, like the rest of them, characterized by the energy frequency and the energy density of the energy itself. I remind you, the energy frequency, it shows the capacity of creation, the strength of the energy. The higher the energy frequency, the greatest the capacity of creation, that is, ability of transformation. But the less the density of the energy involved. there is a feature into the emotional spectrum that it is of extreme interest. It indicates that assuming that this is a two-dimensional description of all the energy available, then that means that every horizontal line that I have drawn here, any horizontal line, has on the left-hand side the same frequency and density as it has on the right-hand side. Okay? Simply because that's how I have modeled the whole thing. Which means that a particular emotion that exists at this spot and a particular emotion that exists in the across the board here have the same frequency and the same density, although emotionally speaking they are of extreme difference. Well, here we have at this vertical line we have the emotion of insecurity. The emotion of insecurity is a very powerful emotion. It's actually what makes us work like mad. What makes us really trying to survive. Insecurity is fear itself. It is the fear that makes us work hard. Otherwise, if you are not fearful, you don't do much. You just enjoy. On the other hand, across the board, we have security. So, insecurity, security. Same frequency, same density. Yet, think about that. An insecure person who is ready to kill to survive, a secure person who you cannot even kill because he knows he cannot die. A disaster for the system if you are too secure. If they are capable of scaring you to work hard, then you are useless for them. They want you to be insecure. Okay? But if you are secure, you don't even think of them as worthwhile to just watch them and feel sorry for them. What a difference an emotion can make, eh? There are two extreme emotions into this emotional spectrum model that characterize this spectrum, this emotional spectrum. On the left-hand side is fear. On the right-hand side is unconditional love. Now, fear is the emotion that keep us running. It's the emotion of productivity. It's the emotion behind that supports ingenuity. It's behind the particular emotion is practically everything productive. But from the point of view of philosophical reality, it's a disaster because it does not take into consideration you as a person, but the requirements and the necessities that they are essential for the whole group of societies to survive. As long as you are fearful, you'll be able to be productive for the rest. Otherwise, you wouldn't. On the other hand side, unconditional love. Now that's a beauty. That's the real unconditional love, which means that the people who feel that in the extreme case, they don't have, that they are not afraid of anything. They are ready to give you anything they have, anything they have, never ask you anything in return. Okay? Never ask you anything in return, and they are just happy to exist. they are living their own small nirvana themselves.